All right, good evening, and welcome to our Wednesday night service here at Freedom. Let's all grab a hymn book and stand together. If you need it, hymn number 413. We'll sing Love Lifted Me all together on that first verse.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore.
Singing, you may be seated. Pray for the choir as we sing, Because He Loved Me.
Yeah.
glad my sins are covered by the blood. Well, let's all stand and grab them together, and let's grab a hymn book, turn to hymn number 99, and we'll sing, Isn't He Wonderful? It's a chorus. Isn't He Wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful. Let's sing it out.
Isn't He wonderful?
Come down and join you. Turn around and greet someone. Let them know you're glad to see them in the house of God tonight. Let's sing that chorus out again.
Isn't He wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's Word. Isn't Jesus my Lord?
Sing it again.
Isn't He wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's Word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
Amen. It's so glad to see you in God's house this evening. I'm excited to hear from God's Word tonight. Just in the middle of the week, it's so nice to be able to come to God's house and worship and get something from His Word. And I'm excited to hear God's Word tonight. And so, it's time for our tithes and offerings, and I'd like to ask Brother Ricky if he would pray for us.
Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day, Lord. Lord, I'm thankful that our sins are covered by the blood, Lord, and thank You for Your grace and Your mercy. Lord, thank You for the music we've heard. I pray for the preaching tonight, Lord, and may we set aside all distractions. And Lord, I just pray that You be with this offering. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles tonight, Esther chapter number 10. Esther chapter number 10, we will conclude our series tonight on the book of Esther. Esther chapter number 10, and thank you for those that have been here every single sermon. Thank you for hanging in there through this, and I hope it's been a help and blessing. I know it has me, I guarantee you that. And let's bow for a word of prayer, and then we'll have a song, and then come back with a message tonight. Father, we thank you for your goodness. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here. And God, I just pray that you'll bless this song. I pray you'll use it for your honor and glory. God, I pray that you'll help me, fill me with your power, your spirit, I pray. Lord, I pray you use your word to change us for time and eternity. And we'll thank you and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and they found a Savior.
Chapter number 10 tonight, in your Bibles. And as I said, it's been a joy going through the book of Esther with you. And we see the mighty hand of God at work, even though it's not mentioned in the book of Esther, that God's name is not mentioned. But his hand is clearly seen and evidenced in this good book. Esther chapter number 10, and we'll begin reading verse number 1, Esther chapter 10. You're going to say amen to this one. Shortest chapter in the book of Esther. Verse 1, and the king Ahasuerus laid a tribute upon the land, upon the isles of the sea. Now, this tribute is basically forced taxation or servitude, either one. It could be forced wages or taxes paid to the government, or the government just taking it out of your hide, like working you and getting their money that way. So this is what he did. In verse number 2, and the acts of his power and of his might and the declaration of the greatness of Mordecai, whereunto the king advanced him, are they not written in the book of the chronicles of the kings of Media and Persia? For Mordecai the Jew was next unto the king Ahasuerus, and great among the Jews, and accepted of the multitude of his brethren, seeking the wealth of his people, and speaking peace to all his seed. Now, D.L. Moody was born in Northfield, Massachusetts in 1837. Who's read any biographies on D.L. Moody? Anybody read that? Sword of the Lord used to put out one. And so he was born in Northfield, Massachusetts, a very poor family, and at age 17 went to Boston to work at his uncle's shoe store, as they used to call it a cobbler. And so he went to the shoe store to work, and it was there that God used a Sunday school teacher, Edward Kimball, to lead D.L. Moody to Jesus Christ. And so Moody prospered as a shoe salesman, but in time he left the business to pursue God's will for his life, which was evangelism. For the next 38 years, until the day he died, Moody labored to make Christ known to the world. Now, during his ministry, he traveled more than 1,000,000 miles, and it's estimated that he preached to more than 100 million people. Now, this was before the days of PA, public service announcements. This was obviously the day before internet, but even before radio and television, and to reach 100 million people. That's a lot. It's a lot without any help, so to speak. It is claimed that he personally dealt with 750,000 people. Now, this is a shoe salesman that allowed God to use him. Do you know that God can do anything with anybody that will let him? Doesn't matter what your background is, where you come from. Now, I tease the Nichols and Jake and him about low gap. I know it's just a joke, all right? But, you know, in our little area, circle of influence, it would be like that. If God can use somebody from an insignificant place, he can use anybody. It doesn't matter, and we've seen testimony and example after example in the Bible of how God used people. They didn't have the best credentials. They didn't have the best background. They didn't have the best upbringing or circumstances, but God used them. And I lived 16 years in an apartment, and I was well taken care of, but I wouldn't have been the number one pick to do anything. And you know, you probably wouldn't have either. I mean, I wasn't the number one most likely to succeed in North Davidson yearbook. Now, I did good in school. I didn't blow my time. You know, I didn't waste time, because I didn't like school. I want to go ahead and learn and get out. They didn't want to stay more summer school. No. No summer school, no repeat, no none of that. Like, it about killed me when they told me I was going to have to take Algebra 2 one more time if I didn't do something better. Guess what I did? I did better. And then went on pre-calculus. I didn't want to do that no more. But, you know, it doesn't matter where you're from. My dad got saved, but he was an alcoholic, lived in that little old place down on Payne Road. But you know what that matters to God? Nothing. No matter where you came from, no matter what your circumstances are, surroundings, God can do something with anybody that'll let him. The only difference between Moody and most of us is because he let him and we won't. That's the difference. Because you can't say, Pastor, it was his showmanship. He didn't have any. He didn't have a lot. You can read up on his biographies. He was not known for his flowery speeches. So you can read up. Now, I don't believe God puts a premium on ignorance. I've heard people almost gloat about the fact that they're unlearned. That's not biblical. Because God expects you, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might. So this idea that God puts a premium on ignorance, that's not true. You know, God knows I can't do no better. Well, God doesn't make junk. Amen. And educationally speaking, there's no reason in the world. Now, I believe our educational system as a whole is highly watered down and very loosely educational at all. And I'm not talking about high school or elementary school. I'm talking about college. Everybody's going. Everybody's graduating. Can I tell you, used to, you just didn't pass. All this idea about passing everybody. These people passing school now can't even write. They just pass them on. They don't want to deal with them. They just pass them on. That wouldn't happen in my day. I can see Miss Tesh. She was right. Y'all probably had a Miss Tesh in your life. I mean, she was something. She was a first grade, but I thought she was like Gestapo. And I can just see the principal coming, Mr. Kennedy coming to Miss Tesh and saying, Miss Tesh, now, his parents are upset. We got to get this kid on through school. We don't need him 16 years old in the first grade. So we need to move him on, just kind of move him on. Miss Tesh, I guarantee you what she would have said, she'd have quit first. She'd quit. Now, what's the big deal? We don't even read. I mean, America has been so dumbed down. And we think it's a good thing they don't write in cursive anymore. They can't even write in cursive. If you write in cursive, they think it's Chinese anymore. Now, the way some of us write, it's debatable. But I'm not getting off on a tangent. I'm just saying God does not put a premium on not doing the best you can. You ought to do the very best you can with what you got. Because he said, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might. If God gives you the ability, you ought to do it first class. Do it well or don't do it at all. Do it well. Moody did with what he had. Personally, spoke to over 750,000 people. It's amazing what a man can do yielded to God's service. John Wesley, 200 years ago, the Spirit of God enlisted this man for the gospel ministry and for the advancement of the gospel. He ministered for over 50 years. In that time, traveled a quarter of a million miles, preached 40,000 sermons. He averaged 800 a year for 50 years. Now, if you multiply 3 times 52, 3 sermons a week times 52, that don't equal that many. I can tell you, that's a lot of sermons. It's a lot of work. It wasn't easy to prepare. It wasn't easy to preach, but he did. And through his ministry, scores of people came to know the Savior. And it's another testament to what God can do with a person who's yielded to him. God can do anything with anybody. And maybe you're thinking, you know, I would like for God to make a difference. I like for my life to make a difference for God. And I want to be used for his glory. But I'm no Moody. I'm no Wesley. Can God use me? Of course God can use you. The Bible is full of ordinary people that God used to do extraordinary things. And we've watched Esther and her cousin Mordecai accomplish something spectacular with God's help. I mean, they were not even exactly doing what God wanted them to do. They should have never been where they were. But God took them where they were, and God used them over time to change the course of a nation. Now, in verse 1, back to chapter 10, and the king Ahasuerus laid a tribute upon the land and upon the isles of the sea. Now, this tax, and really, is he doing any different than he did? No, a pagan ruler is still in control. Well, Ahasuerus was still in control, just like he was when the story began. When the book began, he was in control, and he was ruling over 127 provinces, and now he's exacting taxes, so he's still in control. And when this book ends, he's in control. So what was he doing when the book started? Whatever he wanted. He's going to parties. Remember that? And when the book ends, he's still doing what he wants. I mean, he threw, in chapter 1, he threw two parties. One lasted 180 days. So we come to chapter 10. What's he doing different? Nothing. You know what would be a tragedy? Is to live and die in the Bible Belt and have a mediocre life. You know what a tragedy would be? To hear Bible message after Bible message after Bible message, encouragement after encouragement to do right, to do more, to live for God, to give him your life, yield him your life, surrender your life, and message after message after message after message, time after time after time after time, and be no better at the end of your life than we were at the beginning. What a tragedy. What a tragedy. And he did that. He possessed power. He ruled as king for 21 years. And in verse number 2, it's documented all the acts of his power and his might were documented, all of it. And the declaration of the greatness of Mordecai, that was also documented. They had a record of his life, of Ahasuerus' life. And, you know, when God, this king that does whatever he wants, do you know that even he did not upset the plan and purposes of God? Even Ahasuerus, who had power, he had control, he had all he wanted, but yet he did not even upset the purposes of God. God still done what he wanted to do. And he used his people to do it. So in your life, in the grand scheme of your life, I don't want you to get discouraged when you think that some human, some finite human has the ability to squelch God's power in your life. Or some event in your life has the ability to stymie the power of God in your life. That's not possible. Amen. Brother Mike, it feels like it's real high, but not body. And I don't know if that makes sense. And I don't know if you may have already done all that. But it just feels like I'm real high end and no low end. But to think that God can be thwarted or limited by what's going on around you, that even though this king was in place, and you know, I've heard people say, man, we live in the most wicked culture. We live in the worst time ever. We live, I mean, this is, it's terrible. It's bad. And we'll go out at Walmart and we'll talk, boy, it's bad. It's terrible. Look at that bread, how high it is. Look at all the, I mean, and it's just so high. I was watching Price is Right the other day from back in the 70s. This stuff was high then, too. It's funny how things change, like their value. Like they, I mean, when's the last time anybody sold a grandfather clock recently, like a new one? It's funny to watch what they're giving away grandfather clocks. I thought, man, you couldn't pay somebody to come get that thing now. And other stuff that would, a big old boom box, you know, just as big as, I mean, the biggest is half this platform, you know. And toasters, microwaves, just real high because it wasn't. And to think how things go. But, you know, it's not, it's bad. But can I tell you what's exciting about now is the fact that we're closer now to the return of Jesus than we've ever been. And there is nothing that can happen here that is outside the plan of God for our lives. Even in the midst of the worst king, I mean, Ahasuerus had no inclination to do right. God did right in spite of him. I don't care how hard it is at your job. God can use you to do right on your job. I don't care how bad this world gets and how dark it seems, God can use you to do great things for him, even in the midst of a dark and perverse world. And, you know, our educational system, we have some public school teachers here, and God can use you in this hour. Now, I'm not for what's going on in the public education system. Absolutely not. Redefining genders and teaching kindergartners about drag queens, I'm not even remotely, but I am for people trying to live right and do right and trying to make a difference. I am. Because the world's not going to get any better. I mean, we can try to, it'd be like trying to take one of your little sand buckets like you go down to the coast with one of them little sand fiddler, one of them little yellow plastic buckets, trying to bail out the Titanic with it. You're going to be busy. It's not going to happen. So what we got to do, we're not going to save the ship. Forget that. You're not going to save the ship. America's going down. You're not going to save the ship. We got to get as many people off the boat as we can. That's the goal. Hey, you can't deny God, turn your back on God, and live immoral for generation after generation after generation and expect God's blessing on our nation. That's a mockery, really, to even expect that. But God has put us, for Esther 4, remember? He said, what do you know, Esther? God's put you here, quite possibly for such a time as this. So God has strategically placed us, and we see in verse 3, Mordecai the Jew was next unto the king and great among the Jews. So right under the king you have Mordecai. So God took a terrible situation and formed it for his favor. He saved his people using Mordecai. Now, what did God do for Mordecai? He's second in command, second in the kingdom. And who held the position before Mordecai? Can somebody help me? Haman did, right? God took care of him. Haman's gone. He got hung on the gallows, his own gallows. His estate now belongs to Esther, managed by Mordecai. Isn't that something how God works? You know, I was talking to somebody today and just something, the craziest thing in the world happened. I mean, it was unbelievable. You ever had anything happen like that? Like, you couldn't have wrote this? I told him, you know what? I said, there's more chances of a pink elephant being born down at the Ashburn Zoo as this happening. I said, it's crazy. Crazy what happened. And I got to thinking. I thought, in relation to our conversation, I said, you know what? I said, this is not an accident. I said, you better start fasting and praying because this, God set this meeting up before the foundation of the world. Before time, I mean, before there was, he figured this out. That doesn't scare me that God knew this was going to happen. And I said, boy, I would be scared to death because the chances, humanly speaking, of this happening, what happened? Second, I mean, there are no chances. God put it together. I said, boy, you better be real careful how you respond in this moment because God put this together. Amen. God put this meeting together. Like God brought you and brought them from two different spectrums of the world and right here. You know, we need to understand God is sovereign. He is in control. And He's ordering our steps. He's directing our steps. And so Mordecai was second in the kingdom. He's respected by his peers among the Jews. It says, great among the Jews, high esteemed, respected. And really, there's only one way that can explain, one thing that can explain this story and how it worked out. God did this. God did. When I got done today talking, I said, there's only one way to explain this. God did it. God did it. And boy, we need to look for that in our life. And we need to discover what God did through Mordecai. And it was, y'all, you that are older than me, and I'm not saying you're old because the older I get, everybody looks younger, right? That Yogi Berra was catching for the New York Yankees and Hank Aaron was for the Milwaukee Braves. You remember that? He's a power hitter for the Braves, Milwaukee Braves. They were playing each other, and Yogi Berra had a knack for chatter and trash talk and just running his mouth, you know, and wouldn't stop, and just ceaseless chatter. And he wanted to pump up his teammates, and he also wanted to distract Hank Aaron that was at the plate there. And so he told Henry Aaron, he says, hey, Henry, you're holding the bat wrong. You're supposed to hold it where you can read the trademark while he's up there batting, trying to distract him. Hank Aaron didn't say a word. When the next pitch came, he hit the ball to the left field bleachers. Home run. He crushed it. I mean, sent the ball flying. After rounding the base, he tagged up at home plate. Hank Aaron looked at Yogi Berra and said, I didn't come up here to read. I didn't come up here to read. And you know what? We didn't come to mess around. We got to understand, you're not here by accident. You're here on purpose. And I think that's one of the great disservices that the Big Bang Theory and other theories do to a generation is to make them feel like nothing more than a ball of protoplasm. No worth, no purpose, just swimming around in society, as it were, with no future, no hope, no meaning. But I want to tell you, you were created with a purpose. Before the world was formed, you had a purpose. God knew you was going to be here tonight. And God has a purpose for your life. And it's our job to be focused on what God has for us. Just like Hank Aaron, he said, I didn't come up here to read. And we didn't come to waste our life. Because who knows, Esther? God's brought you here for this time. Amen. Who knows for you? God could have created you in any. You know, how many of y'all have ever done this? I've done this before. I said I should have been born another era. I'm old timey. I like old. I'm like that. Like I'm like an old man. Well, I am an old man now, but when I was 16, I mean, I was hanging out with the seniors, you know, not senior hires, like seniors, 65 and older. I mean, honestly, that's who I was hanging out with. No kidding. I mean, my papa was my hero. I hung out with him. I hung out with people at church. It was on the front, them old men on the front row. That's what I liked. I didn't even hang out in the teen group. I felt like it was a demotion to go to teens. I'd stay out with the old men. It's just kind of odd, but so I've always thought, man, he was born in the wrong generation, you know? Hold on a minute. No, I wasn't. No, you weren't. God knew exactly when you were going to be born, and he put you here right now. It's no accident. What are you doing? Are you going to be like Ahasuerus? When we come up to chapter 1, he's doing this stuff, the foolishness. When we come up to chapter 10, he still ain't learned. Man, I don't want to get to the judgment seat and God kind of shake his head. And I know it's not for punishment because he took our punishment on Calvary. I won't be judged for my sins because he was. But I'd hate that. I'd hate that. I can just imagine. Now, I'm not saying it's going to happen like this, but if it did, it would hurt me just to watch Jesus hang his head and think, after all I did for you, this is all you got. And I'd hate to disappoint my Lord. I know how all my life I've wanted to please my daddy. I think every child around has some desire. Some daddies make it hard on the babies to do that. But I've wanted to all my life. And I can't imagine not wanting to please my Heavenly Father. But just think of getting to heaven and just hanging his head. We come to the end. Hopefully, all that God has put in your life will make you better when you end than when you start and when you begin. Now, I want to ask you this question. You say, preacher, I want God to use me. And you know, he did work for the Jewish people. He spoke up for peace. He left behind a great legacy, Mordecai did. And the Savior, he came not to be served, but to serve. And that's what Mordecai did. Maybe you're here tonight, you say, Pastor, I want to do something meaningful for God. I do. I want my life to count. I want to do something significant, but I can't. I don't have what it takes. Maybe you'd say, I could really serve God if I had this, if I didn't have this, if I didn't have this, but if I had that, if I had this, if I didn't have this. And we make excuses about if I had this or if I didn't have, but that's not true. Are you willing? Are you willing? I want to ask you this question tonight. I want you to forget everything I've said except this. Are you willing to serve Christ right now where you are with exactly what you have right now? That's the question. Because we all like to put it off like, well, when I get situated, when I get settled, just let me settle in a little bit. When I get settled, we're going to serve the Lord. When I get the kids grown, we get that. Well, you know, everybody makes their excuses. When I start getting that pension and I retire, boy, things are going to be different up the church because I'm going to be up there all the time, Pastor. I'm going to be bugging you all the time when I hit that pension because I'm going to retire. I'm going to have all the time. Never see them. Never see you. What happened? Well, I had to pick me up a few jobs. You know, if you won't serve God where you are with what you have, chances are you never will. That's a cold truth, but it's the truth. If we won't serve him now with what we have, we won't when we get whatever. If we won't serve him now. So I'm asking you, are you willing right now to serve the Lord with what you have. Will you put Christ first right now? Where you are, put him first right now. And if he desires, if God desires, he can promote you or demote you. He can give opportunities or take them away, just like he did Mordecai. He gave opportunities for them to serve. God took a man who was headed for a hanging and promoted him to second highest position in the land. God turned it around. And God can do it for you. I'm just going to read these wrap-up statements here about the book of Esther. We've already said it. God is in control. God's in control of your life. God has a plan for your life. He operates by a plan. God will take care of his people. You remember that. When you're watching the news, just remember, God will take care of his people. Amen. I'm speaking primarily of Israel because that's exactly what happened. He'll also take care of his bride, the redeemed, but he'll take care of the nation of Israel. And the Lord specializes in taking people from where they are to where they should be. Where are you tonight? And where should you be? They weren't even where they were supposed to be. But they ended up there. Where are you tonight? And where should you be? And by the way, you can't clean up your own act. God has to do that. It's a work of God. And God gives opportunities for those who want them. God gives opportunities for those who want to use them for his glory. And the key verse in verse 15 that I've mentioned throughout the sermon, who knows? I mean, for such a time as this, the key phrase, God has put you here. God has brought you here. Have you surrendered your life to him? John Wesley said it this way. He said, I want the whole Christ for my Savior, the whole Bible for my book, the whole church for my fellowship, and the whole world for my mission field. I wonder tonight, will you serve Jesus where you are, right now, with what you have? Not after this event, that event, not after this, that. Nope, no, 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 no. Right now. Yes or no? Yes or no? Do you know that the world's never seen what God can do with a yielded church? There's not enough power in this world to contain us. Just us. At Freedom. If we would all yield ourselves to him. And say, I don't care what anybody thinks. I don't care what people say. I'm going to yield myself fully to Jesus Christ. I'm not going to worry about who says this, who says that, who don't say this, who doesn't say that, who applauds, who likes it, who don't like it, who loves me, who don't love me. I'm going to please Jesus with my life. Where I am, right now. Well, if somebody just, you know, if they just give me a chance. No, where you are with what you have. We all like to make excuses. All like to make excuses. Well, if they'd asked me to do that, I'd be doing that. Well, I've learned in life, 30 years of ministry, people do about what they want. That's the truth. I know about what, and husbands, you do well. Learn. If you've been married 10, 15 years, you ought to know what your wife likes. Amen. You ought not have to ask, you know, what they like. I know when it comes up on anniversary or, well, birthdays or Mother's Day, I know what's fixing or getting ready to have to happen. It ain't buying roses down at the store. It's going to Lowe's and getting some yard plants and taking that big old auger in the middle of brick chips that's been in there for centuries and digging a hole in that yard with that auger to plant plants and put down pine needles, make everything look real neat. And that's what, I mean, that's what she would rather have a work day at her house than anything in this world. Like just everybody stop what you're doing and just come work at the house. That's what she wants. Now, it'd be easy to do the other. But you know, I know what she wants, and I know what I'm supposed to do. And really, I don't have to ask. If I ask her where she wants to go eat, you know what I'm really doing? You know what we do? We do it. You can act like you don't. We do it. My mom's the best at it, but she's not here, so I'm not going to pick on her. But we all do it. I know already where she wants to go eat, okay? The only reason I'm going to ask her is why. Because that's not where I want to go. Because I already know. 30 years, I know where she wants to go eat. Well, I can tell you right now where it is. I'll tell you in front of everybody tonight where it is. Home. Ask her anytime, day or night. Hey, babe, where you want to go eat? Home. Don't Arby's sound good? Yeah, we can go to Arby's. But the only reason I said Arby's sound good because that's what I want with that big old roast beef. But if I don't even ask her where she wants to go because I know where it's going to be. Home. We got stuff at home. Now, that's a good wife, by the way. Let me just tell y'all. We got stuff at home. I got turkey. We got ham in the refrigerator. We got that leftover roast in there. Let's just go home and eat. So my boys won't even ask her no more. Because you know who they're going to ask? Where are we going to eat? Me. Because they know I'm in for that, you know. Let's go to Linda Vista. Mom says, go home. I want to go get some enchiladas. Right? You know we do God like that. We're fine serving him as long as it fits what we want. If it's self-serving, we'll do it. Pastor, I want to buy new chairs for the men's Bible class. Well, do you know why that's so special to them? Because that's when they teach. Now, everything needs to be nice. But I'm saying, tonight, I don't want you to think of what I want to do and how can I get God to agree with me. I want you to say, God, where I am right now, tonight, with what I have, I give it to you. And I want you to use me like I am. No strings attached. No clauses in the contract. Just, I will. Father, thank you for this night. I pray you'll help us to honor you with our life. God, help us to give you everything. Everything. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you're here tonight, you say, Pastor, I'm here, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure if I die tonight, I'd go to heaven. Pastor, I'm not sure that I'm saved. Pray for me. Is anyone to raise your hand and say, Pastor, I'm not sure that I'm saved. Pray for me. Would you lift your hand, anyone like that? Pastor, pray for me. Anyone, would you lift your hand? Say, pray for me. Just take it up. Slip it up, take it back down. Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure that I'm saved. Pray for me. Anyone like that? Who would say, Pastor? No, nobody's looking but me. Nobody. I don't go talking about who raised their hand, who didn't, who's all that. Pastor, I sincerely desire to do God's will for my life. I want to. Would you lift your hand? I believe you. Is there any stipulations tonight? Is there anything that you wouldn't do? I want us to think about it. Can you say, I will serve him now, right now, with what I have? Can you say that? Let's stand together. Ms. Carter's going to play. I'd ask you to come and Let the Lord help you. Let God help you. Let the Lord help you tonight. Would you come? Would you come? Let God help you. Mama, Grandma, can you say that? Daddy, Papa, can you say that? Would you come? She's going to continue to play another verse. Would you come? Just say, Lord, I want to be used. I really want to be used. I want you to use my life. Would you come?